So we have a very cool demo here for you today on the IoT Show, and that's LoRaWAN playing a role in the Industrial Metaverse. But we'll learn more about where LoRaWAN is at, where it's going, and that's with Johan from the Things Industries and one of the leads of the Things Network community. That's today on the IoT Show. Hi, everyone. This is the IoT Show. I'm Olivier, your host. And today, we'll talk LoRaWAN. And for that, we have Johan with us. Johan, how are you, man?
Hey, Olivier. I'm good. Thanks for having me.
Well, thanks for joining us. I think it's evening for you. Where are you calling us from?
I'm calling from Amsterdam, the Netherlands.
Okay. Perfect. Well, thanks for joining us here. For those who don't know you, because some people know you, especially if they're already in the world of LoRaWAN, LP1s, and so on, but not everyone knows you. Who are you?
So I'm Johan. I'm a CTO and co-founder of the Things Network and the Things Industries, and we build LoRaWAN cloud services.
Okay, so I think lots of people know what LoRaWAN is, but some still don't, right? Maybe they've been living under a rock or something. If you're in the world of IoT, I'm sure you know what LoRaWAN is. But Johan, can you give us your little pitch so that we all get ramped up on what LoRaWAN is?
Yeah, sure. So LoRaWAN is a standard protocol. It's really designed for low power, long range wireless communications, and it's a standard communications protocol. And there's a whole ecosystem of device makers, network operators, cloud service providers, and it's really designed for these battery driven sensors that are supposed to last for years, and that are sending sensor readings maybe a few times per hour or a few times per day.
Nice. And so you said you work for the Things Industries, and you also created long time ago a community around LoRaWAN, right? Which is the Things Network that goes along with open source software that allows developing LoRaWAN solutions with different bits and pieces that need to be on the device, on the gateway, in the cloud. So you have a long time experience, you know, yourself, the community, your partners, and so on. What do you say is the actual state of LoRaWAN in the industry? What's the adoption rate? So is it actually becoming something more and more present?
Yeah, for sure. So LoRaWAN has been out there now for, let's say, 7 years. So it's already quite some time. And it's really part of this wave of LPWAN IoT, so low power wide area networking. And LoRaWAN is not the only technology in this field. So it's also narrowband IoT, LTE-M. And the adoption has always been quite challenging for developers, because most developers who are building IoT solutions are used to these, always on devices that have, high bandwidth. They can always communicate, get information from these devices. And these devices are typically not battery driven. And so the class of devices that we are talking about here are constrained devices. So they are running on a battery, and you basically only have like once or twice an hour, like a small communication possibility with them. And that comes with all sorts of challenges, but it is growing rapidly. We are connecting now over a million active LoRaWAN devices on our network. So we're getting there, yeah, for sure.
And there is a notion of public and private networks as well with LoRa, right? Which is pretty interesting, especially in industry, because the notion of public network is that you can basically open up your gateways so that any LoRaWAN device from anyone can connect to the cloud through their gateways, versus, hey, I want to lock it down to my own device to optimize on my bandwidth and so on. So like, can you tell us a bit more about where things are standing when it comes to public versus private?
Yeah, so that's really the unique thing about LoRaWAN, because it uses the unlicensed spectrum. So you don't need to have like a license on a piece of spectrum to set up a LoRaWAN network, like you would have when setting up a cellular network or private 5G. So everyone can set up a LoRaWAN network for their own use cases, but we also see network operators deploying LoRaWAN networks in countries. And it's the very same technology, and even there are standards for exchanging traffic between public and private networks. So you can really get the best of both worlds. Some solutions really require, indoor coverage with gateways that you can actually control, and other solutions, maybe using the same devices, can rely on coverage provided by public network operators. And this is all covered by LoRaWAN.
Yeah. And there's another aspect which I really like with LoRaWAN is you guys and others, players in this realm, have created an ecosystem that make things very much plug and play. You have an ecosystem of sensors, LoRaWAN sensors, and they have a little QR code on them, and you want to activate that sensor, you just like bring it out, there's a gateway at range, you just like snap the thing, and now you add it to your collection of devices and it disappears, right? Versus, hey, I have to have an SSID for that Wi-Fi thing, and I need to provision that, and so on. Like, LoRaWAN actually is interesting because of that almost plug and play, or I would say plug and play way of working, which is very interesting, and that allows different players to join efforts, right? You can have different sensors from different manufacturers, one gateway, things just work.
Yeah, right. So just to illustrate this, we have a small demo.
At
the Things Conference, which is our yearly conference in Amsterdam, which is all about LoRaWAN. It's a two-day event. And we built the largest digital twin using Azure Digital Twins. And it really shows how what it looks like to build like a conference venue that is a digital twin and have many different LoRaWAN sensors contribute to one model. So I even had a sensor that I was wearing that was measuring my heart rate and my body temperature.
Okay.
But there were also different booths by different vendors that were measuring humidity, temperature levels, but also trash can levels and things like that, all combined in one view. So that's one of the use cases that you have. And this is typically covered by gateways, a few gateways that are deployed in the conference venue.
Okay, well, that's a very interesting scenario here, because that venue actually was gathering, as you were saying, many different people, actors, companies, and all contributed to that same one big industrial metaverse demo that you've seen there. We'll definitely share more pointers to that demo, because I think people will be interested. It goes beyond just being a demo, actually. It's using production tools. It's production Azure Digital Twins. It's using the new 3D tool for building your 3D models. It represents all the data in that web view that you have up there. How do you see LoRaWAN playing a role, actually, in the growth of the industrial metaverse? I know it's a fancy word, but it's really about connecting the physical world with the digital world, right? Creating digital twins and working with them. How do you see LoRaWAN, taking its part or a role in that market?
So LoRaWAN is definitely not the only solution in many IoT deployments or like even if you want to get like a digital representation of the real world, you need connected sensors, right? But we don't expect that all of these sensors are going to be LoRaWAN. But LoRaWAN is really designed for these low power devices, mm-hmm. but it's also like a horizontal technology that you can use for many, many different types of sensors, like we showed with the conference. A digital representation of the real world, the industrial metaverse, needs connected sensors. And LoRaWAN is definitely going to contribute to a large part of that because many of them will be battery driven.
Yeah. So one thing the demo demonstrated actually just realized that is the fact that I heard a lot of people, saying that, oh, LoRaWAN is great for outdoors. You see all these like smart farming, demonstration. You did all of that indoor in an industrial building, which is a pretty cool building, by the way, where you have your event every year. But it's an industrial building, was all the metal around you and so on. So LoRaWAN is doing great in these environments as well, right?
Yeah. So it's a sub gigahertz frequencies that are used globally, and so that goes really far, and it works really well to get through walls and everything. And if you don't have coverage, it's gateways are getting really cheap. With under like $100, you can buy a gateway, plug it in a power outlet, and you can cover easily a conference venue like this with a few gateways.
Nice. So talking about this kind of like networking over the year, questions, 5G versus LoRaWAN, is it like a versus or is it 5G plus LoRaWAN? What is the story here between different types of technologies like that?
So I think the beauty of both is that they are both generic. So they don't focus really on metering or on specific use cases. You can really build all kinds of technologies on either of them. We see them really as complementary. LoRaWAN is really designed for long range and really low power use cases. And it's really easy and cheap to set up your private network. You don't need a license, you don't need anything like that. We see it as complementary because gateways that are providing network coverage, they also need an internet backhaul. And for that, we increasingly see cellular to be used. So gateways that have a cellular 5G backhaul, and a LoRaWAN is basically used for the last miles, the last, you know, 5-10 miles, the wireless connection with the end nodes.
Yeah, so definitely complementary, right? So I like that.
Yeah.
So one thing that actually it brings up, you just mentioned gateways, and so when people start thinking about gateways, they might start thinking about, you know, some compute, some way of having more happening at the edge. And I know you guys are working on evolving the LoRaWAN technology. Today we're talking about LoRaWAN as, you know, you have the sensors, you have the gateway, gateway is connected to the cloud, and you have a LoRaWAN network server that runs in the back end in the cloud that allows to identify the devices, decode the messages that are coming from devices, and so on. How do you see that evolving with lots of companies looking more and more into bringing workloads at the edge, on premises, and start doing this decompression, you know, decoding of messages and more at the edge?
Yeah, so we expected, you know, a few years back, we expected that all these workloads would transition to the cloud at some point. But we more and more believe that there are specific workloads that are required to be run on the edge. Mm-hmm. So for that, LoRaWAN is a star of stars networks. So at some point, indeed, like you say, the messages go through a network server, and if that network server is in the cloud, but there might be a spotty connection with the cloud, or there are, you know, data requirements, requirements like that, it might become challenging. So what we are working on is a way to also locally deploy the Think Stack, which is our product, which is our network server, on the gateway that is still orchestrated by the cloud. But in case there is an internet outage or there are use cases that need to keep the data local to act quickly, for instance, it would still work with LoRaWAN. So it would be like a hybrid mode.
I'm sure you're triggering lots of interest here. So what do you recommend people do if they want to start working with you about, you know, LoRaWAN in general, implementing solutions, as well as looking into what LoRaWAN is becoming or will become as you are evolving it to serve these kind of scenarios with edge compute, industrial metaverse, and so on?
Yeah, so our website, thethingsindustries.com, contains a lot of information. Deployment models. We also have a lot of resources to learn about LoRaWAN, and we have a use case wizard that really gives you inspiration about what it takes and which components you need, where you can buy them to build solutions. And we also recorded a video, 1 hour video, that teaches you everything about LoRaWAN. It's just 1 hour of your time, and you basically learn all the important fundamentals if you're new. If you're brand new, learning about LoRaWAN for the first time.
And it's really worth it, actually. I watched it, and you learn a lot, thanks to you, Johan, because you're presenting that one. Perfect. So we'll bring that link as well down here for our viewers. Johan, thanks for the update on where LoRaWAN is at. I know I will see you again on the IoT show sometime soon. It was not the first time we were here, and that's not the last time. So thanks again for calling us and for being here with us.
Thank you.
All right. Everyone, see you soon. And you know, if you want to learn more about LoRaWAN, we have links. And don't forget to sign up for the IoT show. See you soon. Bye.